Welcome to the new home of country favorites in the Hudson Valley. This is Real
mama kissing Santa Claus underneath the mistletoe last night. She didn't see me creep down the stairs to have a peek. She thought that I was tucked up in my bedroom fast asleep. Then I saw mama tickle
92.5, 96.5. Real country. Hey! Double wide quick stop, midnight tea, top jack in a cherry coke town. Mama and daddy put the roots right here, cause this is where the car broke down. Yellow dog school bus, kicking up red dust, kicking us up by a barbed wire fence. MTV on the RCA, no AC in the vents. We were Jesus, Sammy, blue jean baby, born in the USA. Trailer park, truck stop, faded little map dots, New York to LA. We were teenage dreaming, front seat leaning, baby, come give me a kiss. Put me on the cover of the Rolling Stone, uptown, down home, American kids. Growing up in little pink houses, making out on living room couches, blowing that smoke on Saturday night. A little messed up, but we're all right.
Hey!
Hey! Baptist church parking lot, trying not to get caught, take her home and give her your jacket. Making it to second base by saying you went all the way Monday afternoon to practice. Sister's got a boyfriend, daddy doesn't lie. Now he's sitting out back 30-30 in his lap in the blue bug's apple light. We were Jesus, Sammy, blue jean baby, born in the USA. Trailer park, truck stop, faded little map dots, New York to L.A. We were teenage dreaming, front seat leaning, baby. Put me on the cover of the Rolling Stone, uptown, down home, American kids. Growing up in little pink houses, making out on living room couches, blowing that smoke on Saturday night. A little messed up, but we're all right.
Hey!
Hey! We were Jesus, Sammy, blue jean baby, born in the USA. Trailer park, truck stop, faded little map dots, New York to LA. We were teenage dreaming, front seat leaning, baby, come give me a kiss.
On 920 WGHQ, 1260 WBNR, 1420 WLNA, 92.5 and 96.5 FM.
Listening to Kingston Community Radio on WGHQ Kingston. On your radio at 920 AM and 92.5 FM and also online at mykcr.org.
We are Lions. We bring hope where it's needed. Support causes that matter. Change lives. Change communities. Change the world. Visit lionsclubs.org to learn more.
At St. Jude Children's Research Hospital, we're fighting against childhood cancer every day. At the heart of this battle are our donors.
Most of us want to make some type of difference in the lives of others. St. Jude does miraculous work.
The fact that no one has to pay, it's a place where everyone is treated as an equal.
everybody is welcome here. And it doesn't matter your religion or what part of the world you're from, all that is taken away. It just gives you some hope.
It's just a nice feeling to put your energy into something that really does genuinely make a difference in a child's life.
There's just no greater gift. If we have the ability to help, then we have a responsibility to help.
Finding cures, saving children. St. Jude Children's Research Hospital. Find out how you can help at stjude.org.
Introducing the YMCA. Sure, you know the Y for a swim or a game of hoops, but we're more than that. We're a cause. When you take a jump shot at the Y, someone else is getting job training. Practice yoga as a team practices her leadership skills. We give people of all ages, incomes, and backgrounds a chance to learn, grow, and thrive. So while you might think of the Y as the place for lifting weights, we're also about lifting entire communities. That's the Y. We're so much more. Visit ymca.net/more.
Hi, this is Winnie from the Rosendale Seniors, and I support Kingston Community Radio, and so should you.
This portion of Kingston Community Radio is brought to you by Ulster Savings Bank. Visit their newest branch, conveniently located at the Ulster Commons Plaza in Lake Katrine. Experience the difference that local community banking offers with the convenience of another great location, easy access, plenty of parking, and a 24-hour ATM. Ulster Savings Bank, invested in community, invested in you. Member FDIC.
Good morning, Kings, and this is Thunder Thursday. Woo-hoo!
Woo-hoo! Good morning. Good morning, Val Dwyer.
Yeah, welcome.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Thanks
this
for having me.
This is exciting. You look like you shrunk a little bit, though. The chair?
I don't know. I think feel a little short. Oh, that's shorter? No, the wrong way. Hold on. There you go.
So thank you so much for doing this. This is really cool. I appreciate you're the number four cleanup hitter. You know, this is week four in the month, and I'm so happy that you decided to join. Really, this is really great.
I'm honored that you thought of me.
Yeah, so thank you. No, this is every week we have a different co-host and brings a different message, different group of listeners, different group of guests, and exposes more people to KCR. You know, that's kind of the thought. There's something to be said for the same partner. We get that. You know. But I know Lawrence and I, you know, we've had this discussion, and we're going to give this a whirl and see how it goes. I think it's going to be good, you know, different folks, yeah. Right? Yeah. That was a tepid response.
Yeah. It was. I didn't have my mic on, and I just.
Yeah no worries.
I'm great. I'm overly exuberant.
Yeah. So why don't you just let people know a little bit about you, a little background.
Sure.
So, you know.
Sure. My name is Val Dwyer, and I think you know I've pretty much lived in Kingston all my life, with the exception of 4 years away at school and a small visit to Boston for about a year and a half.
Your maiden name?
Arald,
okay.
Yep. So I'm in a family business, a business that my dad started when he was 17 years old back in 1973. Wow. And my brother and I came in about 10 years ago, shortly after I moved back from Boston.
Did you go to school there? School in Boston?
I went to business school in Rhode Island.
Oh, okay.
Bryant.
Okay.
Yep.
Oh, yeah.
So I came back here. My husband brought me back here. We got married in 04. We have two kids. My daughter's a freshman at the high school, and my son is at Bailey, in his second year at Bailey.
Nice.
So
Dennis, your husband, is a local as well.
Yes, he is.
Right?
Yes. Yep. Son of John and Terry Dwyer.
Right.
My father-in-law was a legislator, and my parents are Gary and Lisa Arald. So
great, yeah.
We've all been around a long time.
Yeah, you have good stock. You come from good roots. And that's probably why, you know, at some point, at some level, you decided to kind of get active in the community and what's going on. And I think that's great. It's, you know, amazing that a lot of people just kind of sit home and say, I wish this was different. I wish that was different. You know, what are these folks doing? And you actually, you know, jumped in.
Yep.
So that's really super cool. And so happy you're on KCR, joining the Kingston Community Radio family and getting the message out. And we have an exciting show today, right? Scott Harrington's going to be calling in from Florida. I know, just to tantalize us.
Yeah.
Right?
Oh, yeah, it's 80 degrees
out
here.
I know, exactly.
Shut up. You know. And let's see, at 7:45, we have...
Brad Jordan and Dan...
Dan Ahouse?
Yep, Dan Ahouse are coming in.
Talking about the Kingstonian and other stuff. And they'll be here, I think, until 8:30. A lot to talk about. And then at 8:30, we have...
Karen Clark Aiden is coming in. I've invited her in, one of my favorite people.
Her favorite used to be redhead. She's no longer.
She actually, it's funny. It's funny. I went in there. I was in there. I always go in there to buy Christmas gifts.
Right.
It's such a great place to buy Christmas gifts for my kids' teachers, because you can go in there and buy something, you know, different, rather than a Dunkin' Donuts gift card or something like that. And, you know, there's a limit how many people can come in the store. So my daughter and I were waiting outside to go in, and she came out, and she's now gray. And I just kind of stopped right in the middle of my sentence and said, "Your hair looks so good." You know, it was kind of a funny compliment going gray that, but it really does suit her, and it looks
a lot
great.
Of women have done that. I mean, I you know, my sister is a beautician, and she laments that she's lost a lot of business from the pandemic because, you know, women, she's in Fishkill. But a lot of women have just said, yeah, no, I'm just going natural.
Well, I could tell you, you're never going to be looking at me. I go every 3 weeks and cover that up. I do not look good, Greg.
Come on, my wife is like that. Leanne is like that, too. She still gets her nails done and still gets her hair done, you know, pretty regularly. But
I'm not rocking the gray hair.
Yeah, no. Well, you're young, so that's understandable. But, I would say a lot of women that are, you know, I'll say mature in terms of their age.
That's a nice way to put it.
are going gray. So, But so Karen is one of them. She looks great. So she'll be in the studio. Can't wait. So, a lot going on. Let's talk about, it's Christmas Eve, though, Val, right?
Yeah,
it's Christmas Eve.
Christmas Eve.
And so what are you all going to be doing this year? What's the plan?
We've kind of
abbreviated
split, we've kind of split things up a little bit. We have usually we would do Christmas Eve at our house and then Christmas Day at my parents, but we're going to kind of switch it up a little bit and kind of break the family in half, just so because usually there would be 25-30 people, so we're going to kind of break it in half, and we're going to spend Christmas Eve at my parents. And then we have this tradition with our kids where on both my side and my husband's side, they all have matching Christmas jammies, and they go out and throw reindeer dust on the ground.
That's cool.
So we're going to kind of do a drive-by and drop off reindeer dust and let the kids do that together outside.
Oh, nice.
So we'll do that. And then tomorrow I'm going to do some to-go dinner so that everybody doesn't have to cook. So we're going to do it that way. Yeah.
Okay.
So we're kind of, you know, thinking outside the box. But I'll tell you, it's been a really weird year because it does not feel like Christmas at all.
No, I know. I mean, we're kind of sticking somewhat traditional. I won't say the number of people we're having.
No nine fish dinner this year?
Seven.
Oh, seven.
Seven. Seven fish. Yeah. We'll have at least one person per fish, but maybe a little bit more.
It's got to be just like Thanksgiving, right? 10 or under?
Yeah, something like that. My sister, we've been having Christmas Eve at my sister's for 50 years, you know, long time. And so she, you know, she's a great cook, and she goes down to the Bronx and Arthur Avenue and, you know, gets all great fish and great apps and breads. And I mean, it's an eating extravaganza, which we'll probably still do. Everyone's been in contact with each other pretty much. Mm-hmm. You know, it's all my sons and the grandkids. And so, so it's going to be an eating extravaganza. So it starts around 1, and usually we stop eating around 9.
Well, now this is
but we eat, stop for an hour, you know, fry, and then we'll fry the scallop shrimp. You know, it's kind of like a working deal. And then so apps, stop for a while, then linguine and lobster, big bowl of like 5 pounds, 8 pounds of pasta in the middle of the table. It depends on how many people, but so we eat that, then we stop. get up, take a break, maybe open some presents. Maybe
is this Christmas Day or Christmas Eve?
Eve, tonight.
Oh, okay.
Tonight,
oh, wow.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
So I haven't eaten.
I hope you didn't eat breakfast.
I didn't eat breakfast. No,
is it going on at your house?
No, no. It goes at my sister's house down in Glenham.
Oh, okay,
yeah,
cool.
We're heading down that way. And, so then after that, then, you know, maybe the guys go out, have a cigar, you know, go out, BS on the porch.
Fun.
And we come back in and then kind of sort of starts the, you know, entrees start coming out and all that stuff.
You're going to be full.
Guys, take a break, watch Christmas Vacation.
Oh, there you go.
Christmas Story on Christmas, 8 o'clock.
We watched the Chevy Chase thing, you know.
Do you guys eat? So when my husband and I started dating, his grandma.
Oh yeah, well Terry, yeah, big Italian.
Yes,
I was wondering.
Yes.
Yeah, sure.
Her mom, Graham, Gigi, we call her. She just celebrated her 100th birthday.
Yeah,
God bless her.
Yeah, I know. There's some publicity about that,
yes,
right?
Yes.
Wasn't
there?
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
But she used to make. We would go to her house on Foxhall Avenue for Christmas Eve, and she would make. Is it smelts or what are those?
Well, yeah,
really?
Smelts.
Do
yeah,
you
smelt.
Do that? That
we,
was
we do,
we've
had
so
smelts.
Gross.
Yeah, I don't know how they got into the Italian because they're a little bit Jewish, maybe. But no, I don't know if they are or not. But yeah, we'll have smelts.
Now, do you eat that?
I eat everything.
Smelt is bait to catch trout with.
They're like little
silver.
Almost a what's a not an anchovy, but it's a longer,
like a shad.
Yeah, no. It's a long.
I know. We use smelt to when we go fishing up at Lake George in the spring. We use smelt to catch.
Yeah. There's another small little. It's a long fish. You know, narrow and long. I can't think of it. It may come to me during the show, and then I'll just blurt it out. You know. So we have, you know. Well, I mentioned obviously the lobster, but shrimp, scallops, some kind of white fish, usually cod. The bacala salad. That's cold, and then there's hot. You know, there's regular codfish. I know that's like five. I don't know. The smelts. They're usually in there somewhere along the line. But yeah, now what's happened over the last few years is, you know, my sons are, you know, one is 39 and the other's 36, and they have families of their own now, and so now they're all in their. Sometimes it's a onesie Christmas outfit.
Yeah,
you know,
oh, that's
he's
great.
Like 6 foot one in a onesie. That's a scary sight. It really is. But everybody gets all decked out. I mean, I think we're doing some kind of Christmas pajama theme this year.
Yeah.
Not everybody does it, and that's not, you know, but. Yeah, so we mix it up. And then there's been a tradition in Glenham that the fire trucks come down Old Glenham Road and, you know, all the little ones and Santa, and, you know, that's a big deal. So everything stops at 6 o'clock or so waiting for Santa. And then we all run out to the porch and, you know, wave to Santa and all that stuff. So, we have a 4-year-old grandson and a 18-month-old granddaughter.
Oh, that's nice.
So, yeah, they'll be there. And, and homemade wine, homemade supersod, the dried sausage. Mm-hmm. You know, we have plenty of that. And the olive bread. I love olive. That's my weakness. Olive bread from the Bronx.
Uh-huh.
I mean, it's just packed with olives.
Yeah.
It's great.
I'm not an olive.
Yeah,
that's
not
what
an
they,
olive?
My,
black?
My husband
black
and my
olive?
Son love, they'll eat all the olives.
Olives.
My daughter
green
and I
or
don't
black?
Like,
green
yeah.
or black?
They're
or
black.
Colomani.
They're
no,
black.
Black.
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
Black. Yeah, I love Christmas traditions like
yeah,
that. It's
yeah,
fun. It's, and I think this year you really appreciate them
well, definitely.
Even more.
Yeah, definitely.
You know?
Definitely.
So.
Definitely. Yeah, it's a great, you know, normally a great time of the year. And you know, maybe for one day everybody can just kind of somewhat forget a little bit about what's been going on. I mean, I know everyone is kind of downsizing, mm-hmm. you know, there. I get that. And we are actually too, because usually we'll have, like you, not 25, but we'll have 15, 18 there. We're not going to have that number. And we feel really bad because one young man who is a neighbor and in the military, he always comes home and always is at our Christmas Eve table. And, you know, this year we said, yeah, we're really sorry, but because he's all over God's green earth somewhere, and we just, you know, didn't want to take any risks like that. So we felt really bad. We're going to probably have a cigar and a bourbon with him, though, out in the porch.
Yeah. Oh, that's a good idea.
Yeah,
see, you got to think outside the box
right,
a little
exactly,
bit. You know, you
exactly,
can still.
Yeah. And,
good.
Bourbon,
oh, that's good.
Bourbon defeats COVID, I think. No, that's
yeah,
not true.
Yeah.
That's not true. Don't listen to that.
You heard it here first.
Yeah, right, exactly. Dr. Fauci told me
that
not too long ago. But Yeah, so it's looking like it's the for us. I mean, it's and then tomorrow we Leanne's family will come over a little bit for just a little small group for breakfast, brunch, you know, mm-hmm. type of thing.
And good.
Keep it.
And then
simple.
Do you kind of veg out on Christmas Day?
Yeah.
So I'll say this has been my husband's thing for years. Is he said we're together all Christmas Eve? Why do we have? So I think he's kind of actually
pick
enjoying this a little bit. That there's kind of a reason to stay home and you know play it low key on Christmas Day.
Right.
So that'll be new for us.
So he's one of two, right? He's got John is his brother.
My brother-in-law John. Yeah. Right. Who he took over his family business, Quincy Dwyer and Larkin, uptown.
Right.
And then my husband works at Edson.
Great. Yeah, so that's good stuff. So yeah, I mean, there's so much going on locally and, you know, certainly nationally with all the stimulus stuff. And,
yeah.
I mean, that's I don't know if you're following that, but as a business owner, I don't know if you guys took the paycheck protection.
We did not take it.
You did not, yeah. See, we took it.
We were kind of lucky enough just being in the type of business that we're in. The majority of our customers are, it's municipalities.
Yeah.
And so the beat kind of marched on, if you will.
Right.
So it really, you know, there were times where we work in a lot of prisons, you know, there would be, you know, they would shut us down for a little bit.
Yeah.
But for the most part, we kind of went on. So we did not apply because I didn't want to take it from other people that were impacted and needed it. So
Yeah, we took it, and it really saved our business. I mean, we probably could have gone back to the bank, but I think, you know, it was really helpful for Norman Staffing. And so we used it and used it for the intended purposes, like we didn't, you know, go out and buy car leases and or adult entertainment places. Like
you were responsible.
Yeah, right. and so now, you know, we're obviously glued to what's going on in Washington because of the forgiveness factor and, you know, the reportability of it in terms of the expense side and, you know, So it's a big, you know, deal. And we have Bill Caldera on and Cheryl Bowers, who was going to be on today but couldn't be on, CEO from Rondout Savings Bank. And, you know, so there's a lot at stake. The stimulus is the amount, you know, is one thing, you know, the president involved in that. But the Paycheck Protection Program, in terms of what they had and now what they changed to, is very favorable to the small businesses and probably some big businesses too, which took, I mean, the amount, you could take like up to $10 million, and some businesses took $10
million. Yeah, yeah.
And they said, you know, that was kind of, some of them really, did they really need $10 million?
Right.
So, but small businesses like ours, you know, that, you know, we put 40, 50, 60 people out to work a week, it was important to, you know, because a lot of those went away, you know, during the pandemic. We were down at the height to maybe 15 people working, when normally we have 50, 60 working.
And where are you guys? What are you back up to now? Do you see things coming
back? Yeah.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah, no, we're almost to pre-pandemic levels, you know, probably.
Even with the numbers the way they are right
now?
That's good to hear.
Yep, it is.
I've been happy. Through this, you know, I think as numbers started to spike, we all got kind of nervous about, like, you know, the gym being taken away from me.
Right.
You know, things like that.
Oh,
and
that's a big
deal.
A
lot of that is, it's sanity for a lot of people.
Oh, I know.
Being able to go to work being able to work out.
Yep.
And that's kind of the whole other side of this, is this pandemic. You almost feel like you're being broken down, you know?
We talk about it a lot. You know, the mental health aspect to this, there's a physical aspect. We get that. We understand how contagious, you know, this disease is. But the mental health aspect of this and the impact that's going to have over the next whatever, 6 months, year, 2 years, we don't know how it's affecting kids necessarily.
Kids or people in recovery that have addiction issues.
Right.
It's really that to me is
untold story.
Yeah, it's very concerning.
Folks with anxiety. I mean, you know, if you deal with a lot of anxiety, and a lot of people do out there, this has just been horrible.
Yep.
You know, for folks that are normally struggling with things, now you put this on top of it. You can't do this. You can't do that. You know. you wind up socially isolating, mm-hmm. you know, which is really the worst. I mean, I ran nursing homes for 10 years before I bought Norman Staffing, and the biggest problem in nursing homes before the pandemic was boredom, mm-hmm. was just, you know, just social activity, social engagement. Now, no visitation, understandably.
Isolation, right.
But it makes it worse for the patient, for the resident who's there and wanting to see the loved one or husband or wife, you know,
right.
visited each other.
Right.
And now you gotta, you know, look through a window or something. I mean,
right? My grandmother actually passed away in May from COVID in Tembroke, and she really at this point at that point didn't even know who we were. So
right.
for her, she had very bad dementia. She didn't.
Wait, your grandmother Eleanor passed away?
No, my grandmother okay. Eleanor is alive and probably listening.
Because your grandmother Eleanor, Eleanor is a very big supporter of this radio station.
Yes.
And has been for
many
years.
Yes, she said she had her alarm this morning. Yeah. Yes.
No, when you said that, I was like, what?
No, my mom's mother.
Happy birthday, Ruth Eleanor. Temple. I mean, Merry Christmas, Eleanor.
Well, you can give her another birthday if you want.
How old is your grandmother?
She was born in 32.
Oh, okay.
So 88.
Okay.
Wow. That's
good
great.
For her.
Yeah. Yep. She
God
lives
bless.
Over at the Birches. Yeah.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah.
That's great. Yeah.
So one of the things I found to be interesting during the pandemic is, and as you can imagine, as a working mom, my kids are doing soccer and basketball
and
after school activities, this and that. And somehow my husband and I always managed to get everything done in the house. And now I feel like not having that schedule. I mean,
yeah.
if somebody asked me to do something, I don't even have to say, let me check my calendar.
Right,
you know?
Right. There is no
but
calendar.
There is no calendar.
Right.
But I will say, I mean, it's like my kids are like, Mom, there's no food in the house. I just, you know, it's like 4 weeks. I don't
right.
go to the grocery store.
Yeah, right.
I don't do laundry.
Right.
I don't. And I'm like, how the heck did I get all this stuff done? And I think it's just that thought
out
of
routine. You're out of your routine.
I'm totally out of my routine.
Yeah.
Totally out of my routine.
You know.
And but so.
So I think everyone is kind of hoping, keep fingers crossed, you know, first quarter, maybe more of the same as more people get vaccinated. And I know there's, you know, people are saying, I'm not touching the vaccine. It's unproven. It's untested. I don't do vaccines anyway. All right, fine. But hopefully there's more people that are going to take it. Second quarter, maybe you'll see. Maybe the weather gets a little bit better. We get more outside. You know, mm-hmm. restaurants can get out there. And
yeah.
So I'm thinking by, you know, June, which sounds like a long ways away, but probably isn't. I think maybe a little bit more return to some normalcy. What do you
I hope
think?
So. It's been one of the things that's been fascinating, and I haven't seen the recent numbers, but I did see a few days ago that there had been almost 300,000 people that have already been vaccinated, and just, you know, understanding, you know, it's got to be kept at a certain temperature and all that goes into that. It really is the whole process, and I think they said like FedEx was taking the West Coast and UPS was taking the East Coast, and it really is a fascinating process when you think that it was just 9 months ago that, you know, we didn't even know where this road was going to take us.
I mean, if you're sitting in the studio, and I asked a couple of guests this once, you know, if you're sitting here on Christmas Eve of 2019, you're like,
I know.
Just,
I've thought about that a lot.
It's like, we just had no clue.
I know.
What were the tsunami that was coming.
Yeah. And I'm glad we didn't know, to be
honest.
Yeah,
I know. That's
really
true.
Glad.
No, I agree. I agree. So. Because, we think we probably just would have freaked, but
there would have been the toilet paper would have been gone.
Oh, forget it. Yeah, right. Exactly. Yeah, exactly. But you think about some of the winners in this thing. Amazon was killing it to begin with, and now they're just really killing it.
Yeah.
FedEx. You know, the other one. UPS.
Yes.
UPS. Anytime I go by the Speedway on 32 and Flatbush Avenue there.
Mm-hmm.
There's always one or two of the UPS trucks.
Yeah, I mean, I know. If you hit it just right, you hit them when they're all coming out. It's like a big parade going down the street.
Yeah. So I mean, I don't know. It's, I think out of any kind of tragedy like this, or just turn the world on its ear, some winners pop out of it one way, shape, or form or another. I mean, obviously, there's a lot of folks that lost their lives, and you know that's we're just we grieve for all those collectively and families that lost their loved one during this whole situation. But you know, I think better days are coming. You got to stay optimistic. You got to say, okay, fine, vaccine, social distancing, physical distancing, whatever you want to call it. I prefer physical rather than social, mm-hmm. right? Because we're, I mean, Zoom is a big winner. We talked about Zoom. You know, I'm in heavily involved in Rotary, and, you know, we like Zoom all the time now. And we just did a Highland Rotary Club Zoom Christmas party last night. And I had
so interesting, right? Isn't
yeah,
it such an interesting?
Yeah. Well, you have to worry about DWI because, you know, I was just drinking a ton of vodka last night. And,
that is the good thing. They don't know.
Just, if I can stagger up to my bedroom, you know, I'm fine. Leanne was bowling, so she was out. So, yeah, I mean, it's weird. I mean, hopefully Christmas Eve 2021, it'll be in the rearview mirror at some mm-hmm. level.
It'll look right? a lot different. A lot I hope different.
So.
And hopefully we'll appreciate the little things a little, you know, those different things a little bit more. Like, you know, I the first time I go to, I think one of the things I want to do most is naturally go to my kids' games.
And right.
On the high school basketball team, and I'm really, really, every time I see a picture of her playing basketball, just like,
I know,
stabs
kills
me
you.
In
right.
the heart. But you know, one of the other things I'm really looking forward to is my husband's a Bears fan and my son is a Titans fan, and we had plans. They were playing each other in Nashville.
All right, they're two New York people. How do they wind up rooting for the Bears and the Tennessee Titans? A minute, 2 minutes. So what's the rest of the
story? So we were, and my daughter's a huge country music fan, as we were just talking about. So we were going to go to Nashville.
Oh, cool.
And I'm just really looking forward to getting back to an NFL game, like, you know, stadium or a concert or, you know, something like that.
You see, Lawrence, where the Bills are petitioning.
Yeah, I'm reading that in the Post right now.
Yeah.
And they want to test everybody before they come in.
A little less than 7,000 people for their first playoff game. First time they've won division since 95, right?
Yeah.
Something like that.
6,700 people would be allowed in. The Department of Health, the State Health Commissioner, Dr. Howard Zucker, and a trusted Cuomo aide. I don't know how trusted he could be. They're all looking over it, but
Cuomo said he wants to go to the game.
Yeah, he might get booed. I'm not going to lie.
Hopefully he'll crash on the way there.
I'm not going to lie. He might get booed.
Oh, man.
You guys want to go to break?
Yeah, let's go to break. Coming right back, KCR.
Listening to Kingston Community Radio on WGHQ Kingston. On your radio at 920 AM and 92.5 FM. And also online at mykcr.org.
100 years ago, there were 100,000 tigers in the wild. Today, there are as few as 3,200. The Earth's wild animals can't speak up when they need help. But we can. Be the voice for those who have no voice. Visit worldwildlife.org.
This is Greg Chorvis, and once again, the WGHQ Happy Christmas Fund is asking you to help the needy this holiday season. For the last 50 years, the WGHQ Happy Christmas Fund has helped less fortunate families have a happier holiday. Look for our collection boxes at the local branches of the Ulster Federal Credit Union, Rondout Savings Bank, the Mid-Hudson Valley Federal Credit Union, Ulster Savings Bank, and at the Kiwanis Ice Arena in Saugerties. Thank you very much, and have a happy and merry Christmas.
Hi, I'm Steve Thomas for Habitat for Humanity Restore. Habitat Restores are nonprofit home improvement stores and donation centers that sell new and gently used furniture, building materials, and appliances to the public at a fraction of the retail cost. The Ulster County Restore at 406 Route 28 in Kingston needs your donations. Call our hotline at 845-853-7499 to schedule your free pickup. And thanks.
Long ago, you wouldn't think of galloping on a horse while doing calligraphy, and you wouldn't have attempted to ride your bike while typing a letter. Yet you think you can safely operate a multi-ton vehicle while texting? Behind the wheel is no place to multitask. If you want to BRB, drive now and text later. Lives depend on it.
Visit StopTextStopWrecks.org, a message brought to you by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration, Project Yellow Light, Noise, and the Ad Council.
Hi, I'm Ruth Quick from Town of Ulster. I support Kingston Community Radio, and you should too.
This portion of Kingston Community Radio is brought to you by Ulster Savings Bank. Visit their newest branch, conveniently located at the Ulster Commons Plaza in Lake Katrine. Experience the difference that local community banking offers with the convenience of another great location, easy access, plenty of parking, and a 24-hour ATM. Ulster Savings Bank, invested in community, invested in you. Member FDIC.
He was fine. All right, we're back, folks. This is Thunder Thursday. Tony Marmo.
Ba-ba-ba-boom.
All right, Flash. Wow, she's got it. Wow.
I had to show off for Scott a little bit.
Scott Arrington. She got it, man.
Listen, she is so much better than me.
Oh, my gosh.
We know she's better looking than you. That's for damn sure.
I know it, man. You scored, Tony. You scored for me. Now, I think the new name of the show,
yep.
Throw out Thunder Thursday, it's Beauty and the Beast.
That's a good one, man. I like that. No, I'll tell you what we're trying to do, though, is keep Thunder Thursday and then have a subtitle. So that's a good one. That's a good one.
What's the subtitle? How come I didn't know?
Beauty and the Beast.
Beauty and the Beast.
No,
okay,
the name
okay,
is,
okay,
yeah,
okay.
Because like the first, yeah. Tony Rosa is TNT. That's Tony
yeah.
and Tony.
Yeah, okay.
You know, we're trying to come up with something for Guy Greco. I don't know what that one's going to be. And I got, you know, here
beast
comes.
And beast?
What's
beast
that?
And beast. Beast and Beast.
Beast and the Beast, right. You know, Don Williams is great. That's like Here Comes the Judge.
Yeah.
I said to him, Judgment Day. You know, it's
a
Judgment
good
Day.
One too.
It's
I
ju-
love that.
Yeah, it's Judgment Day. So he started into that. But anyway, how are you, my friend?
I am good, thank you. Tell Lawrence turn YouTube back on. No picture.
Okay, Lawrence, you got to turn YouTube back on. We're pictureless. I think we're getting a bunch of YouTube followers. Thank you for mentioning that, Scott. I just put up about 15 shows on YouTube. So if you want to go back and look at any of our shows, almost back to September, so they're on YouTube now.
Cool.
So this one will
go
up. Part of it will go up maybe today. It's Christmas Eve. I don't know.
Yeah.
But I don't know. Today
so,
or tomorrow.
So, Scott, I think the most important question is what's the weather like down there?
Yeah, thanks, Val.
Let's rub it in.
Yeah.
Let's
right,
rub it in.
Right.
I hope it's raining. No, I'm just joking.
It's not raining. It's beautiful.
Yeah.
I was offshore fishing with my fishing partner, Chuck Schwanger, yesterday. Chuck is a frequent watcher and listener to Kingston Community Radio.
Good for you.
Nice,
and,
thank you.
We had a great day offshore. Interesting side note, on the east coast of Florida, where I, not that anybody cares but me, on the east coast of Florida where we fish, you cannot keep red snapper,
mm-hmm.
which is a delicious eating fish. On the west coast, you can keep them.
Interesting.
You can't catch anything but red snapper.
That's really
you
weird.
You can't
yeah.
get bait to the bottom.
The same state, isn't it?
A big red snapper.
Who makes those rules? Who makes those rules? The locality?
The government.
The government. You know? The government. Ay. The government makes those rules. It's the same government, isn't it? Down there, it's one state, and they say, well, the East Coast fish you can keep, the West Coast fish, you know, blah, 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 or the other way around?
It's a federal water, you know, it's offshore waters, inshore
okay.
waters. It's just always a challenge.
By the way,
how far off is
offshore? I'm just curious.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I'm proud to announce here on Kingston Community Radio the launch, once again, of Blue Dolphin Charters.
Nice.
Oh,
Blue
nice.
Dolphin Charters.
Yeah, we have upgraded to a 27-foot Grady White offshore fishing boat.
Okay.
So offshore is now up to 50 miles.
5-0?
5-0.
You got enough gas to go 50 miles?
That's a long way.
And get back?
That's an expensive trip, the 50-mile trip. But
wow.
You know, we're offering trips from everything from inshore sightseeing, which is relatively inexpensive, nearshore fishing, inshore fishing, and then the real deal, you put the outriggers and the downriggers, and you go out and you troll for wahoo and tuna and sailfish.
Wahoo,
wow,
is, a wahoo
neat,
is a fish.
Yeah.
Chief,
yeah.
wasn't that guy a wrestler, Wahoo? No.
Sure, Tony.
Yeah. Wait, I had another important question, and it just left me when I heard Wahoo. So I don't know. It had to do with fishing, I think. But congratulations, and we're happy for you,
I think that's a perfect job for you, Scott. I'm sure you're such a good host, and
yeah.
Really, really a good entertainer. So I'm sure your guests will enjoy.
I remember what it was now. No, so you obviously can't catch COVID out there because the wind is almost blow your toupee off, right? And when you go out in the, you go out there.
It's the place to be.
Right. There's no way you can catch COVID. The plague out there.
Being in a boat is a good place to be because you're outdoors.
And right. Vitamin D.
You can sit apart.
A little vitamin D out there and 20-mile wind in your face or something like that. I don't know. Maybe not that bad.
And you're right. You can't catch the COVID.
Yeah, yeah. So it's great. You want to share some news, some local news there, Val?
Sure. So, Scott, I'm sure...
I'm sure
you're following. Unfortunately, we wanted to try to keep this positive, but I'm sure you've heard that there was a 12-year-old little girl that was murdered last Thursday night. Have you been following this story?
Yeah. Well, first of all, yes, I have. Thank you, Val. I read the Daily Freeman every day. It is really the only source of news other than word of mouth that I get from my hometown.
The Daily Shad Rapper. Go ahead.
The Shad Rapper, yes. That's always a day late. But to your point, first of all, I want to wish everybody who has supported KCR and me and you and all of us, Val is a corporate CEO, Tony is a business owner and a CEO, I was a small businessman, KCR is a small business, we're a very close-knit local community, and to all of those folks and to all of our citizens and residents, I sincerely wish everyone a happy, healthy Christmas. I believe in the religious aspect of Christmas. This is the day we celebrate the birth of Jesus, and as a Christian, that's our Savior, and that is one of the most profound days in our religion, that in Easter. And so I want to keep that in mind, that this is a time to celebrate what we have, be thankful for what we have, be thankful that God sent His only Son to die on the cross for our sins and to give us the culture and world that we have. So I'm appreciative of that. However, we cannot ignore current events, can we? And I am as profoundly disappointed in the leadership of the city of Kingston as I have ever been in my life. Mm-hmm. To abdicate the responsibility for caring for our citizens, which is the first and foremost responsibility of our leaders, is incredible to me. I never thought I would live to see this day, that the agency that I served for 25 years, proudly, the men and women of the Kingston Police Department, would be forced to give away the worst crime we've seen this year, the death of a child by a shooting, and to say, no, we're going to turn it to the state police. It's just... If impeachment is in the city charter, I hope that someone will activate that. Mm-hmm. I don't know what else to say, Val. And I know how much work you have done with Concerned Kingston to try to move the ball forward, to try to bring people together. You are a kind, well-organized, well-meaning, and you've done the right thing all the way through. And I just can't imagine how the community is reacting. Tell me about it.
It's been a tough week, and Scott, I know you know because you were at the pop-ups. There was a little boy at the end of the summer who lost his life to a stray bullet up in Troy, New York, and he was on all the posters, and he was our inspiration, if you will. You know, don't let this happen to one of our children. And Scott, you were in the meetings with me. I mean, this is what we were jumping up and down, and this is what was in the letters to the mayor, to everybody, that this was going to happen. And, you know, I think I played it a little bit safer than you did. You were a little bit more vocal on the air and about, and, you know, I was trying to start with a blank piece of paper with the mayor. And I just, you know, at this point, it's the gloves are off. and I am very disappointed in the leadership. And, you know, at the end of the day, he sets the tone for this city. I have yet to see a press conference where he puts all of our minds at ease that this is our game plan and that we will not tolerate this and this is what we're going to do. And we're just not seeing it. You know, I think he's great for the bike trails. If we lived in a city of peaches and cream and things were going great, let's go ride our bikes. Love it. But right now, we need a mayor who is a leader and who is going to stand up, set the tone, and fix this problem. He needs to get down to that police station and make this right and start by his relationship with those officers. We're a city of 23,000 people, and we all play a part in this, whether we're an elected official or whether we're, you know, myself, just a community member.
Joe and Mary citizen, right?
Yeah, we all play a role in this, and it takes a village to raise a child, and that child was in our village, and we failed her.
So did they catch?
Well said.
Did they catch somebody?
Scott. So just hot off the press, there was the Freeman did release that they did arrest two men this morning. I haven't had a chance to read the article. I know yesterday there was a raid on Franklin Street, I believe, and there were pictures seen of you know, they were taking out bags of the house. But like I said, I just got a message that flashed up on my phone just as you were calling in that said that they did arrest two people. So
I hope that they are two people who were responsible, two of the people who are responsible for that tragedy. And I will mention to our listeners, it was months ago when the Kingston Police Benevolent Association, the union organization that represents the rank and file of the police department, publicly called on the mayor and the chief to take action and said not if but when a stray bullet kills a child, that will rest squarely on their shoulders. And I'm sorry to say they were right.
Yep.
Perhaps we should start to listen to the people who actually do the jobs and not the people who have never had a real job, who have never signed the front of a paycheck, who have never been forced to do anything. God bless everybody who goes into public service. I appreciate it. But you need perspective when you are making decisions for the majority of citizens. You need to have a background in your life that gives you the ability to separate how important a bike trail is from how important law and order is.
Mm-hmm.
And who is it that's responsible for the safety and well-being of your citizens? What is most important? Like you said, if we lived in Candyland, we could have beautiful bike trails and parks. That's great. And maybe the priority could be changing the intersection so that you don't have to wait an extra second to turn right. Or the tragic circle that's being built out there by the entrance to Kingston.
The tragic circle.
But how about you make it a safe place to live first?
Safety
make
has to come.
Priority.
Yeah, definitely.
Scott, and I've said this to you, safety has to come first. Who is going to walk on these trails and ride their bikes? Who's going to patronize our local businesses if people don't feel safe? I mean,
well, you know, the last time I drove by the crossing, the trail crossing on Delaware Avenue, there was a junkie asleep on the bench.
Yeah, lovely.
So, you know, not something I'm going to encourage my wife and I to do, that's for sure.
Yeah. Yeah, no, it's... I think now there, you want to mention about the vigil on Sunday?
So on Sunday, there is Concerned Kingston will be doing a vigil at Dietz Stadium. It'll begin at 5 p.m., but we're asking people to arrive at 4:40 and to bring a mask and a lighter or match. Candles will be provided. Pastor Don Mapes will be saying a prayer, and I also believe my friend Malcolm Johnson will also saying a prayer. It'll be very short, 15, 20 minutes, and I really hope we can get the community out there and together. We really, really need to come together at this time and be there for one another and send a message that we won't, you know, we won't stand for it. And this little girl, you know, I mean, we're going to pray and we're going to reflect on her, but we have failed her. And this is not, she had a whole life ahead of her. I spoke with her principal yesterday, who just said she was the sweetest girl, full of life. And it's just, it's absolutely horrible, especially any time of year, but especially this time
her
of year.
Her brother was shot too, wasn't it?
Her brother was shot in the arm.
But
yeah,
obviously
he's okay.
Survived. Yeah.
Yeah.
We have failed her, and our leadership has failed us.
Correct.
We have asked for leadership. We have begged for leadership. We have offered to help. We have done, to the best of my knowledge, as citizens, have done the best that we can do to say, please, 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 let's make our city a safe place to live. And it just isn't working.
Yeah, it doesn't get worse than this when you lose a 12-year-old in your community.
Yep. So that's just the latest, and by far the most tragic.
Yeah,
that's four other homicides this year. A great opportunity to segue into your next guest.
What are you watching? You must be watching us because these two handsome guys just kind of strolled in. I'm not sure they're
and they're matching.
They have the same.
It's like red. It's like the red versus the blue.
I know.
The red team versus the blue team. How are you guys?
You guys.
Merry Christmas.
Scott Harrington on the line from sunny Florida.
Scott, very sorry.
Great
for
segue.
Your loss.
Good morning. A great segue. Here are some folks that are working far beyond the capacity of most to improve our city and meeting roadblocks after roadblock after roadblock, although they have persevered. I couldn't be any more proud to call the Jordan family friends and Brad Jordan a friend, and I commend you for continuing to try despite the absurd rejection by the school board, which should be of no concern because they're living in Candyland.
Val, you got
to have
that.
Keep going back to Candyland.
So our other guest, Dan Ahouse, also a community stalwart and been around for quite some time and bringing expertise and guidance counsel to the Kingstonian Project. So welcome, guys. Welcome to the show. Yeah, welcome to the show.
Yeah.
So just give us a quick update, where things are at, what you see coming over the next couple of weeks in terms of who you want to get involved and final push.
Well, thank you. So obviously everybody saw we lost the school 6-3, which quite honestly, we were pretty happy about that. At one point, we didn't know if we were going to get any votes for the school. We were not able to present the project to
right.
them. We were dealing obviously.
Which is crazy, by the way.
Yeah, it was very, very frustrating. It went on for quite a long period of time.
God forbid, Scott, right? You hear both sides of the story.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so anyway, but, you know, the IDA asked them to weigh in, so we needed all three taxing jurisdictions to weigh in. We did very well with the county. Mm-hmm. It was 18-6, unanimous at the city council. So 6-3, we lost by two votes. If you two votes go the other way, we
right.
win 5.
Different story.
So anyway, we've got to go back to the IDA, and that's why if you go up on our website now, KingstonianNY.com, there's some information, and basically it's the hardest thing to get, and no one likes pilots, we know that. And,
right.
You know, and it's,
the payment in lieu of taxes. By the way, that the first word in that pilot is payment.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's the most
it's not like a pilot, which is free.
Right.
It's payment in lieu of taxes.
And Tony, it's funny. That's what was so frustrating to us because as we had school board members making statements like they were running us a check back or they were
right.
they voted no to receive new money. This
yeah,
is $2.7
like
million dollars that they're not going to get if this project doesn't go forward. So when you saw people saying things like, I'm worried about the music program or I'm worried about such and such, we're like scratching our head like, what are you talking about?
Yeah.
If you are worried about any of these programs or any of these kids, take the $2.7 million. It's going to be
exactly.
It's not going to
exactly.
be there if you vote no.
Beats a goose egg, Dan,
yeah.
right?
Versus nothing.
Yeah.
$2.7 million versus
beats a goose
nothing.
Egg.
You know, it's interesting. If you take a step back and really look at the project and what it's trying to accomplish, right? This has been an issue since 2008 when they tore that parking garage down.
Well, right. We tore that parking garage.
And, oh, and the hole in the ground.
That's right. You guys did it, didn't you?
Yeah. Oh, guilty nice. Guilty as charged. Guilty as charged. The red team tore it down. The blue team's going to be.
Yay.
So we were trying then to figure out how to get parking in Uptown Kingston, yeah. right? And how to do projects. And we couldn't figure it out. We couldn't find grants. We couldn't, you know, working with Jimmy Satile and his mm-hmm. administration, we couldn't find a way to accomplish that. And I kick myself now because we didn't think of this really a brilliant, innovative mm-hmm. way mm-hmm. of building public infrastructure
multi-layer,
with
right.
all of the pieces. Benefits. Well, it's not just the multi-layer, right? In this project, you get the parking, but you also get the residential,
right.
which is a built-in market for those businesses in right. uptown. But the way you're doing it, the way that this is structured with a pilot, instead of getting grant money to pay for the parking garage, you're getting tax payments mm-hmm. to pay for it. So the money that they're saving in this pilot mm-hmm. through the tax structure is being reinvested back into public infrastructure.
Yeah.
So it's
yeah.
just a different way of getting right. at it. And right. it's really,
as
Brad was saying, though, it's complex and complicated. Mm-hmm. And it's hard
yeah.
for people to kind of internalize what that really mm-hmm. is. And that's been our struggle, especially with the school board.
People have their special interest in it. You know, it's like everyone's looking at a sliver of it and may what affect them. As opposed to the totality of the project and what it brings. I mean, that's...
And I think you're right, because the other side of it, and the side I always see, right, is you build this project, and first I want to commend the Jordan family because, you know... And
the Benures. We'll throw them yes, in, even though yes. they're from Poughkeepsie. Well,
yes.
Newburgh, close enough.
Well, you know, what I want to say about the Jordan family is they're always the family to step up and write the checks, right, when it comes to yes. not-for-profits, and they really have—they are truly invested in our community. Yeah. So I want to, you know.
And Val, you're right there with us. Tony, man, come on.
Right.
Look at the supporters behind this.
Right.
We've had a tremendous amount of support. We wouldn't still be here pushing this if it
right.
wasn't for the support we got.
Yeah. Yep.
And going in, you know, going back to the presentations that we do, the politicians, I mean, we have a newfound respect for anybody in public service.
Yeah.
I mean, what
right.
they go through, because they're getting the phone calls from the yep. opponents, the proponents, and
right.
and they're, you know, truly asking good questions. And that's why it was so frustrating we couldn't get in front of the school board, because we had to convince, Dan lived it with us, and we had to convince some of the legislators. We had to mm-hmm. convince some of the aldermen. And they asked great questions. Like you were
right.
saying, okay, how does this affect my constituents? How is this going to affect the city of Kingston? Show us the numbers. And by being able to do that and present it to them, we were able to win some of those votes over that, you know, maybe we were a little hesitant at first. And
right.
that's what we weren't able to do with the school. And I think, unfortunately, some of the school board, they got a lot on their plate. We know that. You know,
right, yeah. right. They right. It's unprecedented times right now for the school
timing
board.
Timing was awful.
But, yeah.
And we didn't want to push with them. And we stayed back. We worked very closely with the superintendent. And they were involved when Pat Ryan got involved and mm-hmm. said, okay, we want to do an independent study. Well, you know, that is the third independent study that was done, which was
right.
fine. And we said, okay, you know, let's do it. And NDC did their study. The first meeting, the superintendent was there. The next meeting, the school board president was there. And in the final meeting, when we put the whole thing together, the superintendent was there.
Mm-hmm.
So they did have a seat at the table. Now nobody was, you know, saying that they're representing the 9 voters on the school board, but they had a seat at the table. They went through the process with us, saw what was going on, and the IDA crafted this pilot that Dan spoke about before. In such a way that it truly benefited everybody.
Mm-hmm.
I think the last time Joe and I were here, we were the kicker beyond what we're guaranteeing to pay. It was 5% of the net, whatever our net profit was, mm-hmm. we were kicking that back. The way the IDA crafted this new one, it was 10% of the gross above the benchmark.
What?
10% of the gross above the benchmark. Val's an accountant, so you understand.
Yeah, that's a big difference.
Yeah, that's huge.
And they
money.
Said to us, well, you know, geez, you guys on the doing it the net way, they trusted us, but
right.
you know, and honestly, yeah. said, well, you guys could hire your nephews and your friends, and you know,
right.
lower the, you know, build up the expenses and
right.
take away from us on the net. This thing is, we hit our benchmark, so we were able to satisfy the lenders, which is important. We got to go
yeah.
to a bank and get some
yeah, right, right.
So they know that this doesn't kick in until after the fact, and that's money that's going to go into the general fund. It's not part of your tax levy.
And the mayor
so
knows that.
Yeah, and they can do whatever they want with that money when that comes back
thing,
to the taxing jurisdictions.
The other thing, and going back to what you were saying is about the big picture, is take away just the project in general, and you think about, and especially right now, and Dan, you were touching on timing, and I think actually this will probably work out a little bit better because we've got a little bit of I think we've got a lot of foot track and traffic uptown, and with the pandemic, I think the result will be, you know, this is kind of like a hot up-and-coming place. So I think the timing will work out. But the other side of it is you have to think about that buying power of the people that are going to live in there. Right now, you've got small businesses that are struggling. You've got restaurants that are struggling. All of those people, you know, if those people are doing well, we're all doing well. So it's the buying power of what's going in there. It's a huge besides what you're investing,
like
it's that investment of the people that live there.
Like,
and
it's
a ripple effect.
Well, we said that. It started out all about parking. And now I think the consumers, it's 300 people getting breakfast, lunch, and dinner every day.
I got a $100 parking ticket, by the way. I am one of the people that got a $100 parking ticket.
Karen Clark Gage is going to come on at 8:30 and talk about it. Scott, I want to give you a chance for a comment or question to these guys.
I want our listeners to remember that for many years I worked for AVR Acquisition trying to build Hudson Landing.
Tom Perna, right?
And what the amount of tax money that would have brought into our school district, the city of Kingston, and the town of Ulster was phenomenal. And yet we let our government walk that away. There were some economic issues as well. But had they been allowed to build it when they wanted to, when they dotted all their I's and they crossed all their T's and they got through the State Environmental Quality Review Act fiasco that was presented to them, we still didn't let them build it because Scenic Hudson sued them to stop it. And that's a tragedy.
Yeah.
That's a loss to our community. We cannot lose this project. I don't have any questions. You're a family, and the Jordan family have been so kind to our communities that it's embarrassing.
It is.
Embarrassing that we're not 100% behind this. The school board, a waste of time. I'm sorry. I can't believe that the president of the school board, who I know, would allow this to happen on his watch. But it is what it is, folks. Vote with your... or support with your vote. Support with your vote, and let's get this project moved forward. It's necessary.
Yeah. You know, this is a team game. It's not this is not the Jordans and Benuras doing this. Page is not that. It's the community. In my opinion, it's the community doing this. You know, it's folks that do support this community day in, day out, 365 days a year. Not only you guys, you know, the families that I mentioned, it's we're all in this together, and you know, a rising, you know, when the water rises, all boats rise, right? Rising tide takes the boats right up. And so
way to bring in boats. I like it.
Yeah. The rising blue dolphin. But, Dan,
I agree with you 100%. This is something that is an investment in our community and is meeting the needs of a whole swath of community members, whether it's older families who are looking to downsize and want to stay in the community but can't find the right kind of place that they want to be in, which, by the way, when those larger families downsize into smaller units, they're leaving their home that a family can get into.
Right.
That's leaving a home vacant so that someone else. So it's relieving the stress in our housing market. Young people coming. We saw a letter in the editor from the CEO of Exago, which is a new tech company here in Kingston. He was saying, look, we need this type of housing for young professionals.
Right.
The people we want to bring into our community need a place where they can live. The uptown businesses, like Val was talking about, having that market to support them. But people like myself and Val, and we have young kids.
I have young grandkids.
grandkids and Brad's
beard is not white for
Brad's
a reason.
Kids are older too, but I'm sure for them as well, they want to live here in this community.
Yeah.
They want to stay in this community. We need to grow. We need to invest. We need to develop. And there's no better way. It's one thing if you want to build a nuclear power plant in Midtown Kingston. Okay, let's have. But when you've got people who are local in your community who have demonstrated a commitment to this community, who are looking to invest significant resources into
this community
with all these benefits,
and who I truly believe have the best interests of this community at heart.
But the thing about what Tony, what you said and what Scott said, we have to fight for this.
Yeah.
You know, we can't just assume that because it makes sense to us here in this room that it's going to happen.
Right.
And we have to support
people
our
people have to get fired up about the positivity and what it can do. I think we need to go to break. Lawrence, right? We're going to come back with Brad Jordan, Dan Ahouse. Scott, you're welcome to hang in if you want, or if you want to go catch a couple of tuna, that's up to you. And we'll be right back after the break. We're going to do birthdays when we come back out, and then get back to this great subject.
You're listening to Kingston Community Radio on WGHQ Kingston. On your radio at 920 AM and 92.5 FM, and also online at mykcr.org.
Someone in your town, at your school, or where you work is suffering from Crohn's disease or ulcerative colitis. They're dealing with excruciating pain and days when they can't even get out of bed. Chances are someone you know has Crohn's or colitis. Someone like me. I'm Amy Brenneman, and I'm asking you to support the Crohn's and Colitis Foundation of America to help millions of us cope and to find cures. Visit ccfa.org today to learn more. Help someone you know get back to their lives at ccfa.org.
This is Nina Poshipak. Once again, the WGHQ Happy Christmas Fund is asking you to help the needy this holiday season. For the last 50 years, the WGHQ Happy Christmas Fund has helped less fortunate families have a happier holiday. Look for our collection boxes at the local branches of the Ulster Federal Credit Union, Roundout Savings Bank, the Mid-Hudson Valley Federal Credit Union, Ulster Savings Bank, and at Cantine Field in Saugerties. Thank you and have a happy Christmas.
Think fast. In the short time it takes to listen to this message, a small flame can turn into a big fire. Several minutes more, and thick, poisonous smoke may have filled your lungs and reduced your ability to respond. Give it 5, and your entire home may be filled with flames.
Keep breathing. We got you.
Don't let your world go up in smoke. Have working smoke alarms and practice an escape plan for you and your loved ones. Learn more at usfa.fema.gov, because fire is everyone's fight.
Have you ever experienced a wish come true? For a child battling a critical illness, a wish come true can be a turning point. One song, one dance, one game, one adventure, one moment changes everything. Make-A-Wish needs your support to grant the wish of every eligible child. Visit wish.org now to help grant more life-changing wishes. Together, we can transform lives, one wish at a time.
Hi, this is Winnie from the Rosendale Seniors, and I support Kingston Community Radio, and so should you.
This programming is brought to you by the Friends of Kevin Cahill. As a strong advocate of local broadcasting, Assemblymember Cahill urges you to support Kingston Community Radio with your time and donations. Your contributions keep KCR vital and on the air at FM 92.5, AM 920, and on the web at mykcr.org. Please join Assemblymember Cahill and send your gifts of $10, $25 or more to Kingston Community Radio, Post Office Box 4364, Kingston, New York, 12402. Together, let's keep KCR alive.
Everybody kind of, it was
all right, we're back, folks. This is Thunder Thursday. Flash.
Ba-ba-ba-boom.
All right, we're joined. This is Tony Marmo.
Val Dwyer.
And we're joined by Brad Jordan, Dan Ahouse, and our roving correspondent down in Florida, fishing off the Blue Dolphin today, Scott Harrington.
Scott, I forgot to tell you, if you could see me now, I did shave my head for you today.
Is he there? He's gone.
Gone.
Oh, we thought he was there.
No, I said he's gone.
Oh, he's gone.
He wanted to go catch that tuna, I guess.
Okay, I said right. Tuna. Yeah. Yeah. Bill Parcells.
Or Sean.
All right, we're going to do birthdays real quick and then get back to... all right, you want to read one, Val? You can.
Sure.
That's a long one. You
this
can
is,
read
I'll
that.
Read
that's
I'll
like
take
a
long one.
Story.
Initiation.
I'll take the short one. You're right, exactly.
Okay. Please wish our beautiful and wonderful mom, Phyllis Rosner, a very happy and healthy birthday, number 82, from your daughters, Linda and Rhonda, and a Merry Christmas and Happy New Year to all.
Yeah. Don't you think people with their birthdays on the 24th or 25th get gypped a little bit, right? Don't they?
No.
I mean, definitely as a kid.
Right? As a kid. Or do you do like open presents for your birthday and then Santa's presents? I mean, I don't know. How do you?
I know. And then they
scarring.
Say,
well,
you can celebrate June 24th, but that's not your birthday is your birthday.
I know. All right. So we have another one. Happy birthday to Carol Mazzone. Love Mariana. And William Banks. These Marianne Banks and Bill Banks, they're big supporters of KCR. And the winner of the delicious cow pie from Boyce's Brothers, Boyce Dairy Milk House, is...
Carol Mazzone. Oh, sorry. Carol Mazzone.
The premature bell. All right. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Great. Thank you. All right. So we're back. So I have one thought. I know we're going to segue a little bit into a little bit of a different topic, but before we get off Kingstonian 1, please give the website again where people can go and send a call to action, let's say. If you haven't supported, please do so by...
It's KingstonianNY.com.
Okay, Kingstonian.
And on there it has a lot of the information on the project. And
right.
Where to go is that there's a push-button email. We ask people to put your name and address.
Right.
And tell them, you know, your interest in the project. We've had a great response. The last time we did it, we had over 500 that went out to the school board.
I've sent mine in already, my IDA letter.
Yep.
Got to do it.
I think we just started this one the end of last week again. The letter is going to the IDA. The IDA has the ability to approve the project. And we were the first. We were kind of like their guinea pig in this new process where they asked to go out to all three.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And, you know, what basically happened, you had three different kingdoms playing for the same dollars. Mm-hmm. So you had, entities, and that's really what happened with the school district. They were negotiating against the city of Kingston and the county of Ulster. And where Kingston and Ulster worked together to kind of craft this, you know, the pilot, with the school district, they couldn't get over. They wanted their
but the message is it's new money. It wouldn't even be on the table if you know it's an opportunity. Yeah. It's like OMG.
Right now they're getting.
Why can't we figure this out?
And they recognized it was interesting because they recognized that what the city was getting, right? The city's getting a parking garage essentially for free through this, and the county's getting the sales tax. So it was easier for them for everybody to see beyond the new tax revenue. What else do people get? Well, the city of Kingston gets the new tax revenue and a free parking garage.
Right.
And the county of Ulster gets the new parking garage because they're at the county seat and the bulk of the sales tax. So what's in it for the school? Yeah. And that's what we struggle with. But, you know, the school got the money, the grant, part of this DRI fund, which we were the signature part of the application. The school got the Deed Stadium money, so the city reminded them of that. Hey, but for this project, you've already gotten that. And what's good for the community, we talk about what's good for the community is good for everybody.
Yeah, absolutely.
And we're
absolutely.
All community.
Well, that was the spirit, right, when the community came together to support the construction at the high school, right?
Yeah.
The community understood that a healthy and thriving school district is good for the community. Well, these types of investments are good from the community from an education perspective as well.
But
it's hard to break through that. It's hard, as Brad was saying, the school district, you know, they have a fiduciary responsibility to the taxpayers, and trying to reconcile that issue in their minds, I think, was difficult. And if you look at projects like this around the region in Dutchess County and Orange County, you don't have school districts supporting these pilots. And the IDAs generally don't ask for their support because there's such a conflict there. They aren't as invested in economic development as a city council or a county legislature is. And because pilots by nature are removing money from that would otherwise be paid to these districts, they can't really reconcile that to support it. So the other IDAs don't even ask them. We, for the first time, had to get the support, which was a real challenge.
Yeah, it was very unfortunate. Challenging. And by the way, there's not going to be a ton of kids living in these apartments.
Right.
So it's like, you're getting money and there's not a whole lot of expense that goes along with it from school.
Ironically,
it's not like you're bringing in 100,000 kids.
Ironically, Tony, it's just the right amount. If there are a few kids to come in, it's not going to have an effect on the cost of educating. You're not going to have to create new classrooms, hiring teachers.
Incremental money.
But the state provides money to the school district based on the number of students that attend.
Right.
And we're losing students here in Kingston. So even if we are picking up a few students in this property.
Yeah, it's a plus.
It's a plus.
So I want to make, I mentioned earlier the two cities, Newburgh and Poughkeepsie, both Hudson River cities with a lot of history. You can throw Hudson in there. Nyack actually is a pretty cool city if you haven't been down there in a while. I mean, it's if I wasn't living in Kingston, I'd live in Nyack. You know, it's really a nice community. But we are different and unique in this community because this community does pull together. It does support people in need. It does, I think, more than any of those other cities. Maybe I'm a little biased. I grew up in Fishkill, by the way, so I can say, you know, I'm a Dutchess County guy originally. That is a segmented county, really, Dutchess is. I mean, there's really rich and really not so rich, and Newburgh and Orange County is the same way. They have Middletown. But what this community does, in my opinion, is nothing short of spectacular and amazing when it comes time to pull them together, like the organization you started, like the businesses and people that support charitable giving like crazy in this community. Same people, same group of people, many of whom support this project. So that's why I said earlier, it's a team game, and Kingston is unique, and Ulster County unique in the Hudson Valley, in my opinion. I mean, I have to say, certainly not without fault and warts, like we all, you know, everyone has. But when this community pulls together, it pulls together. Mm-hmm. And we,
deep
you know,
roots.
Deep roots. And you know, everybody's watching out for each other. Unfortunately, we had this death of a 12-year-old, which murder, and you know, you talked about the vigil, which I think is great on Sunday. And, you know, there's a lot of finger pointing going on here, and some of it might be appropriate. And I know, Brad, you're police commissioner. So, I mean, talk about giving, talk about giving back. This guy never stops. Yeah. I mean, it's just, and
he's been on for a long time, right, Brad? Yeah. How long have you been on there?
Put on by
Jimmy. A long time.
Jimmy Zatile put me on.
So wow.
Jimmy and then
Shane
and now it's Steve.
Okay.
So do you maybe have some question or perspective on what's going on? I mean, you know, right? In terms of, because you're very close to this.
Yeah, I know. And we were kind of talking on the break about how obviously, and this has been a hot topic around the community as far as, you know, the idea of policing has changed. And, you know.
Across the country, everywhere.
The country, everywhere. And so we're kind of left in this, well, how can we live in a safe community but also be able to check the boxes of that too? Mm-hmm. And I don't know what the answer is. But I guess what I wanted to talk to you about is there was an article in the Freeman about, you know, the understaffing of the police. And this is also that something that had come up in a lot of the public hearings with the city, with the budget this year. You know, I know they added two officers up to 69. At one point, we were at 80, yeah. Which might be okay in good times. But obviously, right now, I feel personally, as a parent, that safety has to be the number one issue. It has to be the number one concern in the city. And so when I listened to a lot of the callers on the public hearing, you know, my thing was, whatever the chief wants, give him what he is responsible for the safety of the city. If he's telling you he needs something to do his job, you give it to him. But there were a lot of people that were calling in and were saying, that's not enough. We need to get back to 80 people. And then interestingly enough, this article comes out. So I guess as a police
80
commissioner,
people,
80 officers.
80 officers. Yeah. Yeah, 80 officers.
So, I mean, do you think it's realistic that we could slowly get back to that number? Or
as police commissioners, we don't get involved with the budget. That's the one thing we don't. Mm-hmm. We work within the resources that are given to the department. It's an interesting story. I don't know how many people know. We could do a whole segment on the police commission, how it came about. Mm-hmm. But you probably all remember when we were going to go to a city manager form of government. Mm-hmm. And back then, Jim Riggins was the police commissioner. Was the chief.
This is in the 80s?
It would have been early, yes,
early
80s.
Early
80s.
Yeah.
90s.
Yeah, I think it was. I thought it was closer to late 80s.
Were you in Girl Scouts then?
Yeah, I may have been.
But anyway, so, well.
I'm just jealous I don't have gray hair.
I know. I'm going to darken mine.
TR was the mayor at the time.
Yeah.
And he, so.
Well, that would have been the 90s.
Yeah,
that
yeah. It was, mid-90s. I was, I think well, I was in high
so
school.
TR's first term.
Oh.
He was going to basically stepped down.
This is when they redid City Hall, right? When they moved from the
That was before. This is before that.
Okay.
City. It was going to be a city manager form of government. We were switching to by referendum, and before that took effect, TR brought back strong mayor form of government, which is what we're in now under the new charter. And then the only commission that still kept the powers of hire, fire, promote was the police commission. He did it in conjunction with Jim Riggins because without that extra support, he didn't think it was going to pass. So basically, the voters brought in a city manager form of government. Mm-hmm. Before it ever took effect, the voters undid that. And it was probably because of the strength of TR. Everybody, TR did a tremendous job. They switched back to a strong mayor. So we went from, you know, the original mayoral form of government with all individual commissions that had the power to go, then we were going to go to a city manager. Mm-hmm. Before the city manager ever took effect, we went to strong mayor form of government where the mayor sits on all the boards. The boards became, at that point, advisory, with the exception of water's autonomous, but with the exception of the police. So the police board is still kept those the power to hire, to fire, set policies and procedures. But, you know, and it's changed a little bit since that time on some of the discipline stuff because, you know, that gets pretty tricky. Anyway, it ends up going to a hearing officer. But so going back to the original question, the where it's ever from a budgetary standpoint, we don't have any say over that.
And
that's, you know, the groups like yours and how it's going to change is having dialogue. I mean, that's what's happened, which is a great thing because people are coming from all different angles of this thing. Dialogue.
Unfortunately, it comes at a time of tragedy when it's not, you're not ahead of the curve. You're trying to make up for lost ground.
I mean,
right?
I got to say, you know, I was thinking this morning, we've had five homicides in the last year. I don't remember having five homicides in my entire life since I've lived here. I mean, I mean, maybe there were, but really would have to think about it. It's really, we got to put a lid on this.
Yeah.
And I don't know what the answer is.
And then going back to, so, you know, reaching out to your original question, you know, with this most recent homicide, which is awful, and this is what everybody's worst nightmare was, that something like this was going to happen with an innocent, you know, child loses their life because of the crime. Reaching out, I think it was because we already have other murder investigations ongoing within that detective division, and you want to get it right, you want to solve them all, and we want to put an end to this as soon as possible. It wasn't anything to do with the expertise or
lack of.
Yeah, it was that, you know, because
need
of
more
manpower need. And you, when you have major crimes division of the New York State Police at your disposal, willing to help.
Yeah.
How do you say no? You know, and
yeah.
You know, the bigger issues, as you're saying, let's, you know, get our department back strong where it has the bodies there and the expertise there to handle everything on our own. But why not in the meantime, you know, take advantage of whatever's at your disposal?
I think one of the things that that really hurts as far as the lack of manpower is there is a disconnect between the community and the police. And that's really a national issue that has been kind of forced onto our community.
Because the community is split, though, right? The community is somewhat divided?
I think because, you know, you used to, there's a little bit of distrust right now.
Right.
And that's kind of a national topic, if you will. But I think, you know, and I've said this before, is, you know, you can't judge somebody based on the uniform that they wear. So just because that's a problem somewhere else, I don't necessarily think it's a problem here. I will say that there are a lot of procedures in place with the body cams, with KPD. And you know, I mean, if there's ever a question about anything, I mean, the video doesn't lie.
Right.
And the reality is there's not that many complaints. The reality is that a police officer, we don't hear about KPD shooting people. So where I go with the manpower is getting to a place where, you know, a lot of these homicide investigations, I feel, and I mean, who am I? I know I'm not in law enforcement, but would be easier solved if you had the cooperation of the community. And I think that there is a lot of distrust between the community and law enforcement. And a lot of that is because of relationships. And, you know, I think when you're down 11 officers, you don't really have the manpower for a guy to get out of the car and, you know, start talking to somebody, or, you know, those, like, they, you know, they said they used to walk the beat and things like that. And we just don't have that in our budget right now.
One interesting point on that, Val, is back in the 90s and into 2000, you had federal support for our local law enforcement and this COPS program out of the Department of Justice. And we had here in Kingston and in Ulster County a number of police who were out walking the streets and knocking on doors and engaging with the community, and they were underwritten by these federal programs.
Okay.
Yeah, and that's
federal government has stopped doing that. They've put instead military excess equipment into the police, which is controversial, but they're not supporting the communities the way they used to. At the same time that cities like Kingston are under stress from the state in terms of what they can do with their budget. So just trying to reconcile the financing of that is a real challenge.
Yeah, I didn't know that.
The other thing that's really important, you put 70 people together in a room, we can't assume, you have 70 different personalities down here. Mm-hmm. So that's the other thing. You need to understand that it's just because someone wears a uniform, all four of us could wear a uniform, but our personalities are still going to be different.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, if someone had a run-in or a bad experience with one person, it doesn't mean they had that same bad experience with the other 69 or whatever.
You're right.
And organizations like the one you started and some of the other community groups, they're great because everybody on all sides of the aisle really care. I mean, I can promise you that the makeup of our commission has changed, but every commission I've ever been on, including the current one, everybody cares. And everybody, the most important thing is to make our community safe. And I know the mayor cares, the police chief cares, and every one of those guys wearing that uniform, they wouldn't go into that profession unless they cared about what they're doing. Mm-hmm. And community groups that have reached out to us, you could tell. I mean, they wear it on their sleeves. They all care. Mm-hmm. But in a lot of cases, they're coming at it from different angles, and their interests may be a little different. So getting everybody in the room and talking, and that's what's happened. It has been happening this year. Val's aware of it, too. There's been a lot of community meetings.
Yes, I've been at some of them.
There's been there's been a lot of changes in the way that the police officers perform their duties.
Mm-hmm.
And it's definitely headed in that right direction of building that rapport back with the community. You know, then you get something like this. So it's, a slap in the face of reality.
Yeah.
We know we're not there yet.
But
building, when they go to the scene, you'll hear it from these officers. A lot of times they get to that scene and no one's talking. And that's the communication you're talking about.
Yep.
Is the people that live in those neighborhoods, wherever that crime took place, you want that cooperation and say, okay, what did you see? What did you know?
Right.
You know, what's been going on here? And
I have a
thought about your.
And then I have a thought about you. Okay, go ahead.
your 11 people down in the budget, officers down. So, how you generate revenue in any government is through either taxing the citizens,
You build a project uptown and you have those people project,
get your sales tax.
It all ties together. So
the point is the city is lacking revenue sources to support key and essential services like protection, police protection, fire, let's say. I don't know what they're down or if they're down, but those are essential services as well. So you have an opportunity, a project like the Kingstonian, to generate tax dollars and revenue for the city of Kingston, for the county, and we're struggling with that. It just doesn't make sense to me. It's not like we have people knocking on our door saying, hey, I have a new project, I have a new this, I have a new that. Yeah, that's not happening too much. So we have this opportunity. Let's seize it, generate the tax dollars, focus that money on the police. Let's restore that. Let's get the community back involved. Does it sound like I'm running for mayor?
Tony, you're so right. It's a big wheel, right?
Yeah, it's a big wheel, man.
We're all supporting
it. Yeah, it's a big wheel.
And when we go back, that Dan brought up the letter from the owner of Exago. He brings 80 people here. Mm-hmm. He relocated his company here. And he says, when you're looking to take a job somewhere, the questions you're going to ask, where am I going to educate my children?
Yep.
Right.
Where am I going to live?
Right.
Right. They're two very important things in attracting companies like that come up, and that does build our tax base. And going back to our project, if we jump back off the letters and the support, one of the aldermen was telling me the other day, he couldn't believe how many we're getting from downtown, midtown, up from all over.
Good. Yeah, that's great. Yeah.
That's better.
Not just the
good.
Business, the business community.
Everyone so
all
senses the guys,
all
and
those
sees
business
it.
Owners on the Strand are jumping. I'm like, hey, they
right.
definitely see. Like you said, think about your festival.
Yeah. Right.
Where are the supporters? Your supporters aren't just the businesses.
No. They're all over. Yep. All over Ulster County.
Like that, it benefits everyone.
Right. Yep, absolutely.
And I think, you know, I think one of the things that's frustrating for me, and we run into this all the time with projects like this, like, you know, he mentioned AVR, is there are affordable housing projects, which we absolutely need, and they get pushed through. And I'm not saying they shouldn't. However, people need to understand that that comes at a price. And who's going, we need people to be able to pay for those people right. that do need help and do need a break. So it seems like whenever we get to an opportunity where, hey, here's an opportunity where, you know, we're going to be able to build something that's going to be able to contribute to those projects,
right.
there's a roadblock.
Yeah, there's a big
and that's
disconnect
very
there.
Fresh. There's a huge disconnect. Yeah. I mean, you look at those right. projects, how many of them have gone up in the last few right. years? And it's just, it's a different ballgame.
Dan can speak to it better than I can, but there is organized opponents of growth, of economic
yep.
growth, and
yeah.
it's said. And
it is.
I never knew they were out there.
Oh, I've learned in the last that, 3 months.
Wow. Yeah, sure. The lengths that these people
yeah.
will go to
yeah.
to stop progress.
Yeah, sad. It's
oh,
just
they,
sad.
They get personal. They put misinformation mm-hmm. out there. It's just like, really?
They don't speak facts.
No, and yeah. It's,
yeah.
it's frustrating.
Well,
so.
People have to do their own research, do their own investigation in terms of what this project is bringing you know, to this community, the bigger community, the greater community, the employment. I mean, I'm in the employment world, so I know how key that is to get people, you know, back to work. I understand the pandemic has kind of, you know, thrown a big wrench into employment all over the place, and some unemployment benefits are a good idea, but not forever. We keep people on the sidelines and dependent on the government forever. We have major problems. But this is generating jobs, generating activity, buzz, excitement, you know.
Had not, again, I defer to Dan, but the governor, without the help of the governor's office, we wouldn't be where we are right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Starting with the DRI, he's been here twice on press conferences.
Right.
He's helped us.
Good.
Well, it just, it underscores the level of support, well, right?
The mayor's
correct.
Been with
and
us
the CE.
From day
right.
one. If you're
really right.
the one that actually started this. So the full council has been... They were unanimously
right.
supportive. They continue to be supportive.
Good.
They reach out to us.
Yeah.
And we were so
look, I'm confident, and Brad and I talk about this a lot. I'm confident that this project is going to go forward.
Yeah,
the point is, and to what we've just been talking about, it really shouldn't be this
it's
hard.
It's difficult.
For $60 million of investment at no cost
right.
to taxpayers, mm-hmm. the subsidized housing, which again, affordable housing, very important, that's all paid by tax dollars.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This is $60 million of private capital.
Money.
Take out the grants mm-hmm. that you got, a few
right.
small ones, but it's an investment in our community. It should not be this difficult.
Yeah, we're like,
we've got to figure out how to do this
and
better.
And they approached us. I mean, this
yeah.
is not something we
yeah.
we didn't come to them and say,
yeah.
hey,
right.
we have this great idea. Would you guys?
Yeah.
It was the city.
The other way.
Hey, you know,
you
we're
know.
Trying to find someone. Would
generate.
You, would you
yeah.
take your side of the street and you know,
right.
Yeah,
there could be apartments over on the Jordan
oh,
side right now.
We could
and you could have the same parking and other problems, but they've tried to do something bigger and more impactful.
Like Ross Perot said, there's a giant sucking sound happening and it's folks leaving New York State.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
Because of stuff like this
and
we need to change that. We need to
now
change
we're
that.
Getting this influx of people that are leaving New York City.
Right.
And they're not just coming to Kingston. They're going to Pennsylvania, they're going to Georgia.
Right.
We want to get those people.
Right.
Right. Right. The, yeah.
The foot traffic, I have to say, has been amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I can't believe it's like it's kind of crazy because you watch TV and you see clips of New York City and there's nobody on the streets, and then
yeah.
on a Saturday I can't even
that's
drive
like
up North Front Street because there's just
and you know
that's
what,
like a Will Smith movie
it is.
With
oh,
a mutant
I know.
Dog
I know.
You know, in the city.
Yeah,
now.
You know,
Karen will tell you this when she comes on. You get that the Thursday night, Friday, Saturday. Those business owners, they want it
yeah.
Sunday to Saturday
and
yeah.
at
yeah.
night and at, over at night too later
yeah
and, yeah
and there's a, you know all those there's a drive up there now it's
but that this is not a it's not an old issue
with,
no this has been around.
This goes back to when the mall opened up right
yeah.
which ironically is now closed and these shops were looking for that market and
yeah.
It was part of what we tried to address in 08 with Congressman
right.
Hinchey, who was involved in this to create this solve the parking problem but also create a market that's yeah. there on the weekends, that's there at night. These businesses are closing down at times. That doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, get it. Listen, Merry Christmas to you and your family.
Merry Christmas.
KingstonianNY.com.
We support you.
Please get on there. Send in your letter to the IDA. Support this critical project. Have a Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas, Merry Christmas, Christmas you guys. Merry Christmas. Tell Julie.
Eat, drink, and be merry somewhat. Hey, all right, Lawrence, take it away.
You're listening to Kingston Community Radio on WGHQ Kingston. On your radio at 920 AM and 92.5 FM, and also online at mykcr.org.
On top of first-class care, you will never receive a bill. The only thing we had to worry about was just keeping Azalea comfortable. St. Jude saved her life.
Finding cures, saving children. Learn more at stjude.org.
This is Greg Chorvis, and once again, the WGHQ Happy Christmas Fund is asking you to help the needy this holiday season. For the last 50 years, the WGHQ Happy Christmas Fund has helped less fortunate families have a happier holiday. Look for our collection boxes at the local branches of the Ulster Federal Credit Union, Rondout Savings Bank, the Mid-Hudson Valley Federal Credit Union, Ulster Savings Bank, and at the Kiwanis Ice Arena in Saugerties. Thank you very much, and have a happy and merry Christmas.
A message from the American Migraine Foundation.
It's an absolute nightmare.
There's pain that does not stop.
I feel trapped by migraine.
Migraine is a disabling disease.
I feel like I'm dying.
You feel like the world's closing in on you. There's nothing you can do.
It's like you're trapped in your head. There's no escaping it. You can't leave your body.
Don't suffer alone. Make your move against migraine. Visit AmericanMigraineFoundation.org to find help, learn more, and get connected.
We are Lions. We bring hope where it's needed. We are a global force for good. Support causes that matter. Change lives. Change communities. Change the world. We can do more together than we can alone. Join in. Experience the joy of serving. Be part of the movement. Give back. Let's unite the world for good. We are Lions. You can be too. Visit weserve.org.
Everyone is talking about healthcare these days. America spends twice that of other developed countries on our healthcare system, yet our health ranks near the bottom. How can we stop spending so much and getting so little? By shifting to a system that gives more patients access to strong primary care. Primary care can help make America healthy again. To learn more about the benefits of primary care, visit www.healthisprimary.org. This message is brought to you by America's Family Physicians.
Hi, my name is Jackie Lavezzo. I'm from Lake Katrine. And I support the Kingston Community Radio because it is an invaluable resource to the community and its residents.
This portion of Kingston Community Radio is brought to you by Ulster Savings Bank. Visit the newest branch conveniently located at the Ulster Commons Plaza in Lake Katrine. Experience the difference that local community banking offers with the convenience of another great location, easy access, plenty of parking, and a 24-hour ATM. Ulster Savings Bank, invested in community, invested in you. Member FDIC.
I love how he just...
All right, we're back on Thunder Thursday. Flash.
Ba 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 boom.
Crash, crash, crash.
Splash.
Boom.
Stash.
All of it.
Welcome well, to. So this is actually. So Karen, this is my first show, and you.
Yeah, and you are Val Dwyer.
Awesome.
I was asked to pick somebody to bring on, and I chose
so
you.
I'm so honored. And here with Tony Mama.
Yeah, we're having fun.
And it's Christmas Eve. It's a triple blessing.
Yeah, I'm so honored. Thank you, Val.
Our eggnog and rum.
I think you were supposed to bring
it's
that.
In the other room.
It's in the other room.
As soon as we get off the air.
Yeah, right. Boyce's has no eggnog. Somebody was saying, Leanne was saying.
I got some yesterday. It's delicious.
I got to talk to Terry.
They got a new bottle, too.
You do what you need to do, Tony.
So if you're not joining us on YouTube and you can't see, Karen Clark Aiden has just entered the studio.
Hey.
And Karen's a friend of mine. She owns Bop to Totem uptown.
Mm-hmm.
And she's also a huge community leader.
Absolutely.
But so let's talk. We'll talk about whatever you want to talk about. I did kind of want to plug your store a little bit because I think it's a real staple of Uptown, and it's one of those places you can go in and buy something unique for, you know, $20-$25.
Yeah, I mean, we just continually strive to make gift giving accessible to people of all income levels. Because that's not really around these days.
No, it's not.
And so we have, we've been in business for 20 years, and clearly the formula is working. People really, really appreciate how affordable the store is.
Yeah.
And it's great.
Yeah. You know? Well, I witnessed that. I was just actually saying in the first hour, I witnessed that a couple weeks ago when I had to stand out. We were talking about how gray you look with gray hair. That came up. And I said, Tony actually
absolutely.
Brought it up.
Thank
you.
And I said, I was standing outside waiting to get in. And
Bob the Totem, right.
It speaks volumes that there was a line to get in and people were waiting in the cold to get in. So,
I know. Isn't that amazing? That's amazing to me.
So, was it a big decision for you to make not to go color on your...
You know, Tony...
Was it a quarantine issue? Or was it a quarantine
issue? Yeah. I said to myself, when am I going to have the opportunity of 3 months?
Because it takes a little bit of time for it to grow out, right?
It wasn't... After 3.5 months, it wasn't totally grown out. Yeah. I had to go have all the color cut out of it.
Yeah.
But... If 2020 is the year of anything, it's the year of the authentic self.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like,
it's
forget
interesting.
It. Yeah.
Well, you rock it.
Thank you.
Saying to Val, my sister's a beautician, and she's been a beautician for a long time in Dutchess County in the Fishkill area. Mm-hmm. And she's like saying, oh, my God, where's all the business going? Because no one's getting their hair colored. They're going, she's pulling her hair out.
Yeah, a lot of women have decided.
I know.
Yeah, and even young boy, like young children or men are just, you know, they went out and they bought the razor and they're doing it at home. And it is kind of sad. My friend owns CNC and
Iovino.
It is sad what's going to happen.
And he's building a new place out there in the town of Ulster. Beautiful. It looks beautiful. Yeah.
Right. Beautiful.
Well, you know, it's really interesting that you say that because I see shifts in what people are buying.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And it's definitely from the pandemic and from the quarantine. Anything home.
Yep.
That you're going to do at home that you never did at home before.
Right,
and
right.
Maybe you're going to try it at home.
Right.
And there's a lot of home activities. Puzzles, cooking, baking bread. People are like cutting their hair in weird styles. I saw people with different color hair. You know, so there's, I think business has permanently changed from all of this.
Yeah.
I really do think business has permanently changed.
Look at like all the pool companies, Aqua Jet.
Oh, 2022 or 2023. Yeah.
I mean,
exactly.
They're all, and the RVs and
Really,
I don't know. You think 5 years from now, I mean, I don't know if it's permanently.
Yeah.
I don't know. I think 21 definitely is going to be another swing and a miss year. Generally, not as bad as 20 was.
I agree, Tony.
I think 22, people are going to get back to normalcy. And I think by, 23, I think the further away we get from this, I think the better it's going to be. And I think we should know now how to handle COVID-21 or whatever the hell is coming next.
That's just it.
You know, I mean, we have all this machinery, these stupid effing masks that we have.
I'm tired of smelling my own
breath. Come on. How can you go wrong with a gnomie?
That's a gnomie. That's a good gnomie.
Hanging with my gnomies.
If you don't, you wash these things every once in a while. Now I've gotten to spray them with some stuff
maybe a little
aftershave. Yeah. My own aftershave. Yeah. it's like,
I think those are going to be with us for a while.
I do too.
I really do too.
Yeah.
And I agree with your timeline, Tony.
Yeah. Speaking about timelines, let's just go back a little bit. You don't have to, you've been at this for a while in Kingston.
Yes, right? Indeed.
You don't need to say exactly when, but just give us a rough idea how long you've been in the retail business in Kingston. For a while, right?
I ran Anyone Can Whistle at 323 Wall Street, which some people... I opened that store.
Wow.
I opened that store.
When was that opened?
1993.
Okay.
And I worked for them for 6 years.
Okay.
And I was I ran the store, and I was on the road with them selling Woodstock percussion products.
Huh.
And buying products for the Anyone Can Whistle catalog and store. Yeah. Yeah. And ever since when I came to Kingston for the first time, and I think it was 78 or 79, I fell in love with the charm of the architecture.
Mm-hmm.
It's just so charming.
Yeah.
And where are you from originally, Karen?
Syracuse, New York. Born and raised in Syracuse, New York. The real upstate New York.
Yeah.
Right. Right.
Yeah.
The real snow capital.
Up and take a left,
The real snow capital of New York State.
The real flatland.
Yes, I mean, exactly.
Very monotonous. That ride is monotonous.
But you know, Syracuse has been named as one of the top five spots to live post-pandemic.
Really? Why?
Yeah.
Why? What's
they have all these measurements, you know, and critical criteria as to cost of living, healthcare. I mean, healthcare there is phenomenal.
Yeah, yeah.
The cost of living is really there. And the university is there. They have a new chancellor there.
Wineries.
The wineries, yeah. And Syracuse University brings a lot of
people. The guy that used to run Kingston Hospital, Dave Lundquist, is, I think, went up to Rome, New York.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
Running a hospital up there.
Yep, right outside of Syracuse.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Good guy.
Yep.
So you've been at it for a while. You've seen, like, some peaks and valleys.
Yeah, well, after Anyone Can Whistle closed, it really went downhill.
Yeah.
When was that?
The malls were kind of prevalent then, right?
The malls opened in 1987, believe it or not.
Okay, right.
So there was an exodus then.
Yeah.
And it stayed empty for a while.
And then
Gary Kvisev from Woodstock Percussion felt with a theater in the back, he wanted to develop the theater. And here we go.
That's Gary.
Gary.
Yeah, Kvisted.
But it got shot down in the city of Kingston.
Mm-hmm.
Another project that got shot down in the city of Kingston. And so he closed his door. And I said to myself, well, here's your opportunity. You've been charmed by the architecture of Uptown Kingston forever. I knew wholesale and retail really well because prior to Anyone Can Whistle, I ran a manufacturing children's wear company and did trade shows. So it's in my blood.
Yeah.
So in May 26, 2000 is when I opened the store. And all of my friends and family thought I was out of my mind. Uptown was basically a ghetto in 2000.
Yeah. It was shuttered, a lot of shuttered buildings, stores, building,
It was really bad.
There's still a few, but...
There's quite a few, Tony.
Yeah, it's unfortunate.
Yeah.
It shouldn't be that, especially with the mall on the downslide.
Yeah.
You know.
But the New York City developers are here.
Yeah.
And they're buying property.
Yeah. And but they're not necessarily using it in a positive way.
Correct.
Right? They're buying it and keeping it shuttered, maybe. Or
One of the developers is very well known for doing that. And
right.
he currently owns about 50% of Uptown Kingston.
And he's keeping it. See, I don't know about this. So he's keeping it closed
for
what reason?
It's a financial strategy, basically what it is.
Yeah.
We'll
tell you off the air.
Okay. Okay. There's my first slap on the wrist.
That's code for we'll tell you off the air.
Yeah. Okay.
It's it's a financial strategy used by incredibly wealthy people.
Okay.
And we have a couple of incredibly wealthy people here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And one developer has benevolent intentions. Yeah. All right, which is good, and the rising tide lifts all ships.
That's what I was trying to say earlier. I
kind of
stumbled and mumbled and bumbled.
But that's what, and it's the same thing with Kingstonia.
It is.
You know, it's the same thing.
Absolutely.
Because one of the problems, not being a native, but being an astute observer of business and politics in Kingston.
You're an adopted native now.
I'm an adopted native, you know, Kingston is so out of balance right now. It's so out of, we need housing for all income levels.
Yeah.
Otherwise, we're going to end up with nothing but low income housing.
Yep, we were just
and really wealthy people. So there's going to be this massive disparity of middle class.
Mm-hmm.
And I already see it with my customers. They're moving out of Kingston because they don't like the direction Kingston going in.
Yeah,
I agree with that. With what you're saying, I'm just going to keep people thinking about the relativity factor of some of the local river cities like Poughkeepsie and Newburgh. And despite our problems, issues, concerns, it's almost like in the land of the blind, the one-eyed man or woman is king, you know. But so if you look at Newburgh and Poughkeepsie, they can't develop their waterfront. Newburgh has restaurants, but I'm sure their crime rate,
It
was private development, Poughkeepsie can't get their waterfront developed. You drive down. I mean, Leanne and I serve Hope on a Mission, which is a pop-up food and clothing shelter on the corner of South Clinton and Main Street. Every Saturday night, we feed. We don't do it every Saturday night, but Rotary and some other churches feed about 150 homeless people.
That's fantastic.
Every Saturday night.
Wow.
And it's all donated food and money.
That's
so
great.
So believe me, you know, Kingston, with all our warts, with all our problems, with all our lack of leadership, with our lack of unity, is far better. You know, at least we're dialoguing, and we have there's a connection. There's an involvement. We may not be perfect, but I just want us to take a look. If you look at those two cities,
mm-hmm.
primarily.
Mm-hmm.
Compare them to us.
Mm-hmm.
We are better, mm-hmm. but we can be a lot better. Mm-hmm. You know, we can be so much better.
There's a lot
of
deep roots here.
There are. There are.
Yeah.
There
are. You were touching on that earlier
in
the show.
Yeah.
I love to tell this story about when I was at a St. Patrick's Day parade. At the time, I was working in Albany, and I had a friend of mine come down to the St. Patrick's Day parade down on the Strand.
Uh-huh.
And I'll never forget, she just looked at me and she said,
"Oh my God.
Everybody knows each other here."
Yeah.
It's
like Cheers.
She was like, "This is such a neat place because there's thousands of people down mm-hmm. there, but
yeah.
everybody does. There's a lot of deep mm-hmm. roots."
Yeah. Yeah. The question is, we're off the track in certain areas and there's some change in policy that's happened. You know, how do we bring it back to where it needs to be? I mean, we got to speak out, right? I mean, you have to have a opportunity for dialogue. And an ability to have civil discourse.
Exactly.
Without
this right here.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's how it happens.
Without making it personal.
Yeah.
Yep.
You know, if you keep the community in mind and have this dialogue, we'll be further ahead. You know, there's going to have to be compromise, right? That's always the case. But you know, keep the eye on the prize, which is the greater good.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
You know, help those less in need.
Yep.
Get taxes. The tax base up so we can afford affordable housing.
Yeah.
See, that's critical, Tony, is increasing the tax base.
Yeah.
Scott Harrington. Oh, he must want to say hi.
Good morning, caller. You're on the air. Oh, it's Scott.
I'm not just a caller.
Mr. Harrington.
He just can't read lips. That's
no,
right.
I couldn't. I couldn't. I didn't have my mask on. No. Scott Harrington, you're calling back.
Yes, Tony.
Yes, please. Go ahead, brother. What's on your mind?
I called to say hello to one of my favorite people in the world, Karen Clark Aden.
Sass man.
Beg her. Run for mayor, please.
I'll do the sides.
I love you, Scott Harrington.
Rescue our city. Many, many years ago, when I first became a small businessman in Uptown Kingston, I was schooled by Karen Clark Aden while she was at the counter at Nico's Pharmacy. And a friendship was born that has lasted a lifetime and that has involved our family. And she's a great friend of my wife, my sister Kim, my daughter Chelsea. All love, Karen, and as do I.
What's not to love?
I know. We love Karen.
Stop more.
Stop more.
Common sense leadership. And congratulations on your business prowess and your success in Uptown Kingston, and please hold everybody to task.
Thank you, Scott. Thank you. You know I adore you, even though I had to, I did have to school you.
Oh, I'm schooled. Let me tell you, I was publicly schooled.
Yes, but look at the beautiful friendship that resulted from it.
One of the best things that ever happened to me, Karen.
Because if you remember, Scott, after I schooled you, when I was sticking my finger in your chest, what did I say to you?
You and I are going to become friends. That's what
you said. And I said, you and I are going to become friends whether you like it or not.
Or not.
Oh, that's
and
great.
And we did, and you were right. How's that?
Perfect. That's a great Christmas present, Scott. Thank you, sweetheart.
So, Scott, you'll like this because I'm going to bring up some controversy. I want to know why the city is giving out $100 traffic tickets during the rush of the holiday season in our only business district in the city.
I know.
No, I shouldn't say only because Midtown, downtown.
On the Saturday before Christmas.
What the hell is
happening? What did you get a ticket for?
I got a ticket for there were no signs snow emergency.
Oh, you got one too?
Oh, you got a snow emergency. $100
I got one.
$100
And I was out of my car, what, 15 minutes?
Yeah, maybe.
And, yeah. And there was plenty of room for everybody to drive. They were not removing snow.
And there was nothing posted.
There was nothing posted.
What if you plead not guilty?
I pulled up because I had three 65-pound boxes of shirts in my car. I went into the store to get the staff out to help me. I came out. I had a $100 parking ticket.
Yeah. Yeah.
What do you think, Scotty?
That's leadership.
It's called balancing
lack
the
thereof.
Called balancing the budget. Yes.
Not how you balance the budget, but can you just plead not guilty? Just plead not guilty.
I didn't see that box on the. I mailed my money yesterday.
Plead not guilty to a parking ticket, Scott. I think I did once.
You can plead not guilty to a parking ticket.
You can show up at City Hall though and debate it.
Yeah.
What I would publicly advocate for is for the mayor, who's I don't know, maybe he's in a cave. Maybe he went to the North Pole. We haven't heard from him about the shooting. We haven't heard from him about parking fiasco. Come out publicly and say, I'm sorry, that was a mistake. Like I had to do to Karen and say, I'm sorry, Karen, that was a mistake.
Yep. Be a leader, right?
Right, be a leader. Come out and say, I'm sorry, that was a mistake. They're waived. Everything's waived. Where there was a miscommunication. You know, if you want to say there was a miscommunication, whatever you want to do. Do the freaking right thing for once in 6 years. Try to do the right thing. Come out and say there's no fines. We're sorry, and don't do it again. Come on. And just a quick comment on part of your discussion with Brad and Dan Inhouse about public-private partnerships. Karen knows this well because she and I've been friends throughout my tenure on Kingston's waterfront, which was a public-private partnership formed by Mayor Sotile wisely when he found that the city could no longer afford to run a marina because they were losing money every year because for a multitude of reasons, because the city shouldn't be running a business. And a public-private partnership was formed that profited the city of Kingston, provided a public and private service, which was docking on Kingston's gorgeous waterfront, bringing customers to restaurants and shops and parks and events. And it ran in the black. The city got paid. The city made a profit on that. In his infinite wisdom, the mayor decided to cancel our contract a year early. Jeff Correa and I. Jeff is still there with a new partner. I understand it's open. I don't know that it's going terribly well. Those are the kind of solutions that a forward-thinking or progressive mayor comes up with. Public-private partnerships like the Kingstonian to move the city forward. Like AVR, Karen.
Yeah, exactly, Scott.
Hudson Landing, which we chased away. But that's it. I'm done off my soapbox. Don't waste your time. Love you.
Go catch a fish, will you, for God's sake?
Go get a suntan for me, would you?
He's tan already.
Tanned up already.
Are you in Kingston, Scott?
No.
You're in St. Augustine, you dirty bird.
Yeah.
And he's never coming back.
Resident now.
Yeah. Hey, listen, take your tube top down so you don't have any tan lines.
No tan lines.
Take the tube top down.
That's a good one.
The only tan lines are from my thong strap.
Love you, Scott.
All right, brother.
Merry Christmas, Scott.
Merry Christmas to all of you.
Yes.
Thank you, Scott.
Love you. Merry Christmas.
Be safe, brother.
Right.
See you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. It's unfortunate. I thought I saw some new meter reader people floating around Kingston. Maybe they hired him up for this season. I don't know. Just to.
No, Vinnie Perry's the only one that does uptown.
I saw a female.
She's the one that collects the money.
There's two other people.
There's two others now. They're newbies. I think they're temps, not from Norman Staffing.
I think what happened is they took two of they took the repair guy.
The one with the short hair?
Yeah, they took the repair guy and the woman who collects the money and put them on that Saturday to rake tickets.
Okay. Yeah, and because I know there's bags. The snowstorm. Yeah.
There's bags over meters.
They screwed up royally. The whole.
It's somebody like fishing said it was with dynamite.
A sick out. On
it is. It's like fishing with dynamite. That's what they were.
Well, that's what I was. That's
you
what I
ask Scott that and, if he does and, that.
Yeah. And I mean, and the reality is because I mean I love Vinnie Perry, and it's not his fault. This is they're being instructed to do their jobs. You know.
I mean, look, I grew up in Syracuse, New York. They get over 100 inches of snow a season. Mm-hmm. And I'm telling you, those guys, they drive overnight. Even in Woodstock, they were out overnight. Mm-hmm. They cleared the streets, number one, for safety, and number two, for the people and the taxes that they pay.
Yeah.
Yep.
And to not have the streets cleared on the Saturday before Christmas, which in the industry is known as Super Saturday.
Yeah.
Right.
And then you issue $100 parking tickets.
Yeah. Yeah.
So somebody comes in my shop and spends $85.
I spent $180, but I was $280 when I was all.
And then you walk out. Yes. And then you walk out and you have a $100 ticket. How irate are you going
to
be?
I want to know why my picture wasn't on Facebook. I had a bunch of bags. I had like 8,000 bags in my hand.
Tony.
Yes, dear.
You are the Christmas Eve picture on Facebook. I saved that especially for Christmas Eve. And I wish you all could see this because Tony's blushing right now.
No, I am.
The color of his.
Someone take a picture of that shirt you're wearing.
No, well,
put that on our website.
He's got the ugliest sweater on.
It's like Paula's hat for
Paula. I do want to ask one of the because this half hour is going very fast. We only have 5 minutes left. What are we doing? A picture?
Four. Yeah, 4 minutes left.
You guys look this way. Oh, jeez, it's video. Keep going.
Keep smiling. Hold that pose.
We're smiling.
Smiling. Come on. Okay, great. Perfect.
Perfect.
I think this morning is a blur, but I think it was when Brad and Dan were in here, I was talking about how, you know, you watch TV and you see New York City and there's nobody on the streets and then it's Saturday afternoon and I'm with my kids and we're uptown and there's just massive amounts of people all over. And I was just interested as a business owner, what have you seen? Are they patronizing the stores or is it more?
You know, it's a mixed bag, Val. First of all, they're all out of towners on Saturday.
Yes, they
are. There are no locals whatsoever.
Yep.
And during the week, you don't see that kind of traffic. Mm-hmm. You only have it one day a week.
Yeah.
You know? And I would say a lot of them are kind of milling around and strolling and, you know, people are eating and people come in the shop. Some people buy, some people don't. It's a different population of folks. Mm-hmm. It really is. Different vibe altogether, you know.
Yeah.
And there's some wealth that have moved into Kingston.
Mm-hmm.
There's no doubt about it.
Yeah.
There's some wealth that's moved into Kingston, you know. But a lot of folks that have moved up here, they still go into New York,
mm-hmm.
you know. And they do a lot of their buying in New York. Yeah, sure, sure.
Yeah.
You know,
it's interesting. It's been an interesting transition, I guess.
I don't think the transition's over. I think
I don't think it works. I agree.
You know,
I agree. And it will be interesting to see, especially like where we're headed with the housing market. We all know the housing market's been really hot. So that'll be interesting to see, you know, when the dust settles, where we end up.
What I hear my customers telling me is, especially people my age and Tony's age, we're ready to downsize.
And
we'd like to take advantage of this.
I'm ready to upsize.
We are ready to take advantage of this really hot real estate market, and we want to downsize, but there's no place to go.
Yeah, correct.
I know Scott was planning on going to the Kingstonian.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of people were planning on it.
Yeah.
Come on, build it.
You could just roll out of bed and
it's actually perfect for residents. They can walk to grocery shopping, walk to a drugstore, walk to an eye doctor, walk to a dentist.
Great.
I mean,
it's great.
Yeah. We have a minute. Thank you for coming on.
Oh, my pleasure.
Be a regular, right?
Yeah.
Oh, I would love it. Yeah. I would love it.
Be great. So have a great Christmas. Merry Christmas.
Yeah,
Thank you, Val.
Thank you.
Great first show. And
I think this is going to be a great Thunder Thursday. I really think it's going to be a great Thunder Thursday.
She's smarter than Scott, better looking.
Oh, come on.
Oh, yeah, I'm kidding. No.
Definitely better looking.
Definitely better looking.
The phone.
Definitely better looking.
No, he got off.
Scott, actually, I thought you were on the phone earlier.
No,
he's gone. Isn't he listening? Is he streaming?
No. Oh, no, he might be.
No, he's probably watching
YouTube.
On YouTube.
Yeah. By the way, quickly, and then we got to go. People that have contributed to the Happy Christmas Fund but haven't paid up their pledge, can you please do that? We're short like $13,000 of people who said yes. I'll give $100.
So what? You got a Happy
bucks.
Christmas Fund, and you didn't talk to me about it, Tony?
I gotta send Luca Brasi around to collect the freaking money.
Oh.
Oh.
Yo.
Yo. Yeah.
Otherwise, you sleep with the seven fish.
Ah. Oh. You don't eat the seven
get
fish.
You for the happy Christmas
yeah,
fun.
Yeah, get me for the happy Christmas
yeah.
fun.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
We're actually going to have a radiothon on April 1st if you want to be that help keep KCR in the air.
Yeah.
So if you want to contribute to that, we'll make sure we get you on the list.
Yes. Yep, absolutely. April
1st. What date is April 1st?
April 1st, yeah.
April 1st, it's a Wednesday.
Yeah, no fools. All right. Thank you, Lawrence. Merry Christmas to you.
Merry Christmas, Lawrence.
Merry Christmas to you as well.
Gene, thank you for doing all you do with KCR and you two keeping it on the air. And our listeners, thank you for supporting us. Our underwriters, thank you for supporting us. And it takes a community to make this happen. So thank you all. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
You too.
Love each other.
Thank you for sharing the morning.